Today I'm going to talk about sort of some work we've done as part of our Evergraze project. For anyone who is not aware of what we were doing in Evergraze, I'll give you a bit of a background on that, but this work is really followed on from the on-ground research we did over about 4.5 years into a modelling phase to better understand that systems research that we did. So we did some systems research looking at different grazing management systems, and this work that I'm going to present today is really looking at those results and looking at a lot of the what-ifs, and that's sort of how we developed this work. But some really, I think, some interesting findings have come out of it. So we'll just, I'll start with those Evergraze key messages, then just talk a bit about the modelling approach we used, then just talk about profitability of the systems. Now I'll talk about sustainability. Because we're using modelling approach, you can't address obviously all the sustainability criteria, so we're just using ground cover in this case as an indicator of system sustainability, and then just summarising that at the end. So basically, in the Evergraze research, we were really looking at three different grazing systems, and this came out of, I suppose, a lot of contrasting information about intensive grazing management. I mean, really very little research on intensive rotational grazing that was done in a scientifically rigorous manner. So we wanted to look at that at systems level and compare that with some more common management systems that are less intensive and just see how that system differed both at a whole systems level. So that's everything through from animal production, pasture composition, production, some of the soil factors as well, soil water, those sorts of things. Across all those three grazing management systems, we ran a spring lambing merino ewe cross terminal sire system, and our hypothesis was that in the higher intensity of grazing system will increase the profitability and enhance the NRM outcomes or natural resource management outcomes of those system. We also did this research on a very variable site, so we thought that the landscape would greatly influence the pasture productivity and NRM issues across that landscape as well, and we got some information on that as well. So just, I'm only going to talk briefly about these today. Most of the main results from this research are on the web, so you can, if you just Google Evergraze, you can go and have a look at these in a lot more detail. This is just a view of a site from the air, just showing one of the reps of the three systems. We've got the continuous grazing here, which is a one paddock. The animal's basically in it the whole time. This was a 20 paddock rotation where we were moving these animals between that system basically on a flexible basis. So animals remained in the paddocks long enough until they'd eaten the paddock down and they weren't getting their requirements. So we're basically moving them on so that we were trying not to limit the quality of the feed to the animals. And then the four paddock was just moved on a similar basis. This is just a photo of the site, just to show you that it's typical tablelands country, sedimentary soils, quite variable landscapes. The major issue here was we had, up on the top of the hills here, we had very shallow soils and ran down to more productive and deeper soils down there. Acidity problems across the whole site. It was a microlina, dominant native pasture across the site. So just some of the key messages out of the site. We were able to look at the landscape variability, and we were able to map and manage that landscape variability. And this figure down the bottom here shows some of the key differences in the characteristics from different production zones. So this here is the low production zone, was those ridge tops from that photo at the top of the hills. This is your mid-slope area, and these were the lowest areas that were down the valleys. So we found this gradient in coal or phosphorus, and that was not just due to sheep camping behaviour, because in that analysis we actually took out all the sheep camping areas that were obviously sheep camping areas. So we had this gradient of phosphorus, obviously less soil water holding capacity up here, lower pasture production, and then we also had differences in species composition as well. What we found across those three grazing systems was the composition of those native pastures was very stable under the grazing management options. We really didn't have any significant change in composition, particularly in the perennial species across that the 4.5 years of this experiment. And we put this down to we had a very stable pasture composition, very high density of perennial grasses, so we didn't have a high annual component, which would be less stable and allow that pasture to change in composition. But we also managed that pasture so that we maintained a minimum ground cover and minimum herbage mass targets, so that we also didn't damage those perennial pastures, so that would cause them to change composition either. And finally, the effect of grazing intensity on production and profit. There was an effect of grazing intensity on the production and profit of native pastures. Basically, there was two key things came out of this, that there was higher pasture quality and individual animal performance with the continuous grazing. So under continuous grazing, we had better per head performance, but we had higher pasture production, and we were able to increase stocking rate. So we were had a higher production per hectare with more intensive grazing management. But anyway, this is just a bit of a background to lead into the modelling work. So if you want to look at more detail, go to the website. As part of the modelling, we were looking at really two systems two questions, which were some of the assumptions that we'd made in this work, was that flexibility or some form of flexibility is better in a production system, and we set up some rules around flexibility. So we wanted to assess those flexible options against some rigid systems. So set stocking rates, set ewe numbers, set lamb sale times, those sorts of things. And then we want to look at what are the best cues to make decisions about flexible management, and what stage of the production cycle or season would you be making these decisions. So we were trying to look at sort of how would you make a system that's profitable and sustainable, but we're also looking at some of those production system risks as well, so variation in that profit around the mean. We used the OzFarm model to do this, and we did that because it gave us a bit more flexibility in the grazing management options. So most of you out there don't really need to know this, but what you probably do need to know is that we're able to calibrate this model to the pasture growth, ewe weights and lamb growth rates that we achieved in the experiment. So it should represent reasonably well those characteristics from the experiment. We looked at two different options. We looked at one option where we varied the ewe numbers from either 3, 4, 5.3 and 7 ewes per hectare with a number of sale ages of lambs, from selling them early, which is what we would have done in a poor season, early weaning, get these lambs off the place pretty quickly, through to some holding on to them up to 170 days, plus a flexible sale time based on available feed. And the second option was looking at varying ewe numbers. And this came about as, at the start of this experiment, we could have a go at modelling and work out what the optimum ewe number was for a continuous grazing system, but we really didn't know what it should be for the intensive rotational grazing. We didn't know whether it should be the same or it should be different. And over time, that became evident that we had more feed in the 20 paddock and we could run higher ewe numbers. But we didn't know this at the start, so we had some options for varying ewe numbers throughout the experiment. So we just wanted to assess those against some of these rigid systems and see how they would perform if you did this on a commercial basis. Just on the profitability side, across all those lamb sale dates, when you look at the variability around the mean from 5.3 to 7 ewes per hectare, the 4 ewe per hectare was the most profitable system. And the 3 and the 5.3 were about the same, but as you increase in ewe numbers, you also increase in the variability around the mean. So you're getting a lot more variability in your profit between systems. So if we just, this is the same data here, but just graphed out over the 30 years that we ran the models for. And what we find here is this, the dark line here is the 3 ewes per hectare. As you'd expect, a lot more consistent between years, but a lower profit overall. The higher the stocking rate, yes, you do better in the good years, like you have these bigger losses in the poor years. So you're having that I suppose what we'd see or traditionally expect from a more variable, more risky system. This is just looking at those lamb sale times. So this here is the early weaning. So we were doing this in the flexible system in the poorest years, and through to the final lambs. We were selling all lambs if they hadn't met by the end of February to allow our ewes to a month to sort of get our ewes back into condition or make sure there's enough feed, and then before we go back into joining again. Interestingly, the profitability increased up to about this 153 day period here, and then was consistent from that period on. The flexible lamb sale, where we vary between years, was a good option. It was equally as profitable, and on average those lambs were being sold about the second week of January across those different ewe stocking rates. So those flexible criteria, sometimes they would be kept later, sometimes they'd be sold earlier in poor years, but generally they were achieving the same level of profitability, but they were getting off a bit earlier than the later sales. And so the flexible criteria that we were using there was we're using a target weight of live weight of 40 kilos, or when the weight gain dropped below 100 grams per day over a 7-day period. And this is, again, just plotting that data out over the number of years. But the really interesting part about this, I haven't got the flexible treatment in here, but we found that the difference between the production system was very consistent between years. So basically, you kept those lambs a bit longer, then even in the poor years, you were still doing better in those. So as far as this issue around risk, it's a much better way was getting your lamb sale time right for your environment than trying to increase your ewe numbers and your lamb numbers. This is a better way, I suppose, of adapting to seasonal conditions and improving the profitability. Onto the varying ewe numbers. We were looking at varying ewe numbers at two decision points. Because we were not in a self-replacing system, we were looking at doing it either pre-joining, which is probably when most people would do it, and again adjusting at scanning. So we're saying, well, once this is mid-winter, we thought we'd have a bit more of an idea what the season's going to do by that stage, and we could either sell dry ewes or buy in scanned ewes to adjust the sale at that time. We're adjusting on a number of criteria, either the green herbage mass of the pasture, and we're doing it either 3, 6, or 12 months average periods, say for average annual rainfall, and then we were using this temperature. We looked at a few different climate factors, including SOI, and this maximum temperature seemed to be a better indicator than some of the others, so we were looking at that as well. The short thing is, when you're trying to adjust ewe numbers, so this is what we would have considered our best system, which was the 4 ewes per hectare flexible lamb sale policy. Any other policy that we looked at didn't really increase the profitability at all. If anything, reduced it slightly, but massively reduced the risk in the system. We just had much more variable gross margins between years. And that's, I think, because you get it wrong in a lot of times. So you get these downside risk is quite bad when you get it wrong. If you get it right, yeah, there's a good win in the system. You make a fair bit of money, but what you're trying to do is predict the seasonal conditions 6 to 12 months in advance of when you're making the decision, and we all know that is just not viable to do that. So I'll just move on to the sustainability stuff. So again, what we're looking at here is autumn ground cover. So this is just the average of ground cover over autumn out of the model. This is slightly underestimated compared to what we found on the site, but the pattern is very similar. But what we found here is that the higher the ewe numbers, the lower the autumn ground cover. So basically, the more ewes you're running, you're really starting to impact on those pastures, and and once you're sort of starting to get down here below 70%, obviously you're really having an impact on some of your NRMs, your pasture persistence, those sorts of things, which we can't assess in modelling, so aren't taken into the financial analysis here. When we looked at lamb sale age, again across those different ewe numbers, we found that as we increased, yes, there was a slight decrease in the ground cover, but generally it did not change near as much as what it did with the ewe numbers. So the ewe numbers were the big driver of ground cover in this system. So just recapping on that, the autumn ground cover decreased with increased grazing pressure. The earlier lamb sale time generally had slightly higher ground cover. Overall, the ground cover was influenced more by ewe number than lamb sale date. We also found the same trend for pasture dry matter. So we looked at the herbage mass of pastures at this time, and it followed the same trends. So what's driving this is really the stocking rate of these systems. So if you look here, when you move from three ewes up to seven ewes, you're essentially doubling the stocking rate of the system. But when you so this is on average, when you change a sale date from a very early sale date through to the later sale date, you're only actually having a 1 DSE per hectare change in the total stocking rate. So basically, adjusting that lamb sale time is a much better way of adapting seasons than trying to do it where they're changing ewe numbers. So it's about sort of trying to get your ewe number right, and then adapting to season more with your lambs and the sale time of your lambs. This is just looking at those ewe sale options and looking at ground cover there again. So what we found was, this is sort of what we found under the four ewes per hectare, flexible lamb sale. And again, all of those were performing worse where we're trying to vary ewe numbers to respond to seasonal conditions. So again, it didn't do well profit-wise, and it didn't do well on the sustainability side either. So just in summary, flexible management options are based better on altering the sale time of lambs rather than altering ewe numbers. Moderate stocking rates with animal demands weighted towards springs, and this is in a tablelands environment here. With options to decrease stocking rates through late winter and summer if rainfall is inadequate or best. Autumn ground cover can be improved by lowering ewe numbers rather than selling lambs earlier. And while we did this sort of to understand this Evergraze results in a bit more detail, to take this out, and it really needs to be examined in different pasture types, enterprises and environments. But I think there's some interesting findings that should be relevant to people. Thank you.
All right, excellent. Warwick, if you could all join me in thanking Warwick.